people trickling in from being homebound, so we're glad that you're with us today. Let me remind you that the whole bulletin is available to you online, so you can download that and use it on your device if you'd like to follow along that way. If you prefer not to do that, it'll all be up on the screen behind me, so you can follow along that way, and everyone will be able to worship together. If you would like access to our weekly mail out so you'll know what's happening here on a regular basis, please just send us an email. We have been sending out kind of notifications on what's happening next each week on Friday. If you're not getting that, please just send us a simple email, not getting the mailing, and we'll let you have it every week when it goes out. The Utes are meeting in a special meeting this Friday. Big time, so that will mean that their normal Wednesday night meeting outside will not happen, and they will be meeting on Friday. That's in the bulletin. You can see it on our website as well. We have a fun night coming up on November 6th. We weren't able to have the fall festival this year, so we're going to do something just kind of in-house. We'll show a movie and sit outside, have some hot dogs and fun. That'll be on November 6th. And let me also remind you that we're back in the swing of things, having the Lord's Supper on the first Sunday of the month. So that means November 1 will be our next time. Please be sure and register early for that, since we've had a larger attendance for that. That's about all I have to say. Let's worship God.
When morning gilds the skies, my heart awaking cries, may Jesus Christ be praised, alike at work and prayer. To Jesus I repair, may Jesus Christ.
Listen now as God calls us into his presence through this invitation in Jeremiah chapter 10. There is none like you, O Lord. You are great, and great is your name in might. Who would not fear you, O King of the nations? Indeed, it is your due. For among all the wise men of the nations and in all their kingdoms, there is none like you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that we do not come now before a deity of our own invention, but the God who made us. And we ask now that you would bless us and help us to come before the unique and only God, the God who can only be described as holy, holy, holy. Lord, come now and meet with us and dispel the darkness so that we can worship you in spirit and truth. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand now and worship God.
Cherubim and
seraphim falling down before thee, who dare not and evermore shall be.
Upon me.
sunshine of my Father's face. Keep me ever trusting, resting. Fill me with thy grace. Jesus, I am resting, resting in the joy of what thou art. I am finding out the greatness of thy loving heart.
Good morning. You may be seated. If you're looking at a bulletin on a device, you can turn to page 6. You can follow along on the screen also here as we come to our time of corporate confession. This is a read and response, so if you'll join me at the appropriate time. God of truth and mercy, we seek assurance of your forgiveness. We are unworthy to be your children, unfit to be your servants. We are burdened with memories of things undone that ought to have been done, and of things done that ought not to have been done. We need a wider, deeper view of the cross of Jesus Christ. Break us and grant us repentance leading to new joy. Bring afresh the healing and reviving power of your Spirit, that we may lay hold of your salvation by faith and walk in the newness of life, to the glory and praise of your grace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's pause for a moment of silent confession. Amen. Would you hear these words of assurance and grace found in Christ? And I will give you a new heart, and I will put a new spirit in you. I will take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart. And I will put my spirit in you so that you will follow my decrees and be careful to obey my judgments. We ask for a greater display of the Holy Spirit's work in our lives. Spirit, let us see our hardness and stubbornness break and melt under your gracious influence. We pray for a powerful sense of God's presence with us in our daily routines and in the way we love people whom we find to be difficult. And we pray for our church, for people we've not seen for a time, for brothers and sisters in need. Holy Spirit, give us discernment leading to practical acts of love. Father, we give you thanks that during this time that we've been in these past months, that you have led us as a church to love you and love one another. We pray that that would continue, that we would search one another out with those practical acts of love, reflecting the deep love that you have for us in Christ. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. you turn to the next page, in the top of page 7, we come now to the declaration of our faith, a time where we get to declare what it is that we believe. And so if you're here with us, I invite you to rise as we answer this question of what it is that we believe using the Apostles' Creed. And for those at home, you can join us as well. I'll ask you, Christian, what is it that you believe?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son,
seated.
Proclaim your grace and love me. Fill my heart with your praise, I pray. When I stand at the mountain top or the valley of despair, this shall be my cry, my song, my prayer. Surrounds me as I go, Lord, make my life an alleluia. Make my life an alleluia. Journeys and may those left behind
Would you please turn in your bulletins, if you're using one, to page 10 and 11. If you don't have one, you can read this scripture passage on the screen behind me. I'm going to read the whole first part of 1 Samuel chapter 9, with the exception of verses 11 through 14, and I'll talk a little bit about that later on. Let me pray for us, and then I'll read this passage out loud. We ask, Lord, that you would now open our hearts to receive wondrous things from your word. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be ever pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Abiel, the son of Zeror, the son of Bechorath, the son of Aphia, the son of a Benjamite, a mighty man of valor. He had a son whose name was Saul, a choice and handsome man. And there was not a more handsome person than he among the sons of Israel. From his shoulders and up, he was taller than any of the people. Now the donkeys of Kish, Saul's father, were lost. So Kish said to his son Saul, "Take now with you one of the servants and arise, go search for the donkeys." He passed through the hill country of Ephraim and passed through the land of Shalisha, but they did not find them. Then they passed through the land of Sha'alim, but still they were not there. Then he passed through the land of the Benjamites, but they did not find them. When they came to the land of Zoph, Saul said to his servant who was with him, "Come, and let us return, or else my father will cease to be concerned about the donkeys and will become anxious for us." He said to him, "Behold, now there is a man of God in this city, and the man is held in honor. All that he says surely comes true. Now let us go there. Perhaps he can tell us about our journey on which we have set out." Then Saul said to his servant, "But behold, if we go, what shall we bring the man? For the bread is gone from our sack, and there is no present to bring to the man of God. What do we have?" The servant answered Saul again and said, "Behold, I have in my hand a fourth of a shekel of silver. I will give it to the man of God, and he will tell us our way." Formerly in Israel, when a man went to inquire of God, he used to say, "Come and let us go to the seer." For he who is called a prophet now was formerly called a seer. Then Saul said to his servant, "Well said, come, let us go." So they went to the city where the man of God was. And then skipping down to verse 15. Now a day before Saul's coming, the Lord had revealed this to Samuel, saying, "About this time tomorrow, I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin, and you shall anoint him to be prince over my people Israel, and he will deliver my people from the hand of the Philistines. For I have regarded my people, because their cry has come to me." When Samuel saw Saul, the Lord said to him, "Behold the man of whom I spoke to you. This one shall rule over my people." Then Saul approached Samuel in the gate and said, "Please tell me where the seer's house is." Samuel said to Saul, answered Saul and said, "I am the seer. Go up before me to the high place, for you shall eat with me today, and in the morning I will let you go and will tell you all that is on your mind. As for the donkeys, which were lost 3 days ago, do not set your mind on them, for they have been found. And for whom is all that is desirable in Israel? Is it not for you and for all your father's household?" Saul replied, "Am I not a Benjamite of the smallest of the tribes of Israel, and my family the least of all the families of the tribe of Benjamin? Why then do you speak to me in this way?" Then Samuel took Saul and his servant and brought them into the hall and gave them a place at the head of those who were invited, who were about 30 men. Samuel said to the cook, "Bring the portion that I gave you, concerning which I said to you, set it aside." Then the cook took up the leg with what was on it and set it before Saul. And Samuel said, "Here is what has been reserved. set it before you and eat, because it has been kept for you until the appointed time, since I said I have invited the people. So Saul ate with Samuel that day. The word of the Lord. We've been looking at a time of great societal change in ancient Israel. This was about 1000 BC. And at that time, God began to do a new thing among his people. 500 years earlier than this, under another leader named Moses, God rescued his people from Egypt, and then God led them all through the wilderness, and he settled them into the promised land, and then he commanded them that they were to drive out all the Canaanite tribes that were parked on God's land. The Canaanites practiced a highly transactional form of pagan religion. And when I say transactional form, it means you do something for the deity and then the deity is required to do something for you. A transaction, a quid pro quo, takes place that has the initiative residing on the worshiper. The worshiper has to do something and then the deities respond. And they practice this kind of pagan religion where the worshiper bribes the deities, and they would therefore coerce the sky god to give them rain, and they would manipulate and pay the fertility goddess, and she would give them children and make sure their fields and their livestock were productive. And when those gods, of whom the Bible says they are not gods at all, when those idols failed on occasion to respond, then the worshiper was required to up the ante, to give more in an effort to get the god on his or her side. And so the value of the sacrifices would increase until they got to that ultimate cost, which was the worshiper giving to the idol the fruit of the womb. And they would sacrifice their own children to these gods in order to get the gods to do what they wanted them to do. And God clearly and repeatedly told his people that because of their fallen nature, they would find it very tempting to gravitate toward this kind of transactional religion. And God warned them that they would be seduced by this Canaanite paganism if they didn't drive it out of the land. And that this religion, where you pay and control the deities, resonates with our fallen nature. It's like become the default spiritual mode of the fallen human person, to coerce the gods. Failing to trust the God of the Israelites, they did not drive out the Canaanite tribes. And just as God had warned them, they eventually caved in and participated in pagan worship all the way up to child sacrifice. And when you read in the Old Testament, and I've pointed this out to Jewish people before, and they're just amazed that this is in the Hebrew Bible, when you find in the Bible the repeated refrain, they cause their sons to pass through the fire, that's a reference to child sacrifice. And the Israelites actually participated in that. And during this time, in the time of Judges, Israel begins a long downward spiral, goes through these cycles where they sin against God and then they call on God for mercy. And Israel descends into a long period of anarchy and cruelty and division, which is summarized in that chorus. At this time, there was no king in Israel. Every man did what was right in his own eyes. But God hears the cry of his people, and God sends his word in the form of a prophet and priest to the people, and things begin to change. And yet, tragically, their own hearts were slow to change, and they still wanted to be like the pagans around them. And Israel is seduced into demanding a king from God. And yet they call him a king who will be like all the other nations in the ancient Near East. And we're surprised as readers to find that even though they request something bad, God tells the prophet to give it to them. They want a king, and a king they shall have. A king like all the other ancient Near Eastern nations, a king who will take, take, and take. Today, that king finally makes his way out onto the stage, 9 chapters into this book. And today, he makes his promising debut. It's a strange story. And probably if you read this in your quiet time in the morning, you'd say, I think I'll go to the Psalms. You skip over this. What kind of value could there possibly be for you in this passage? And yet it has whispers and echoes and symbols that really challenge the way we read the Bible. And in this episode, we see the uniqueness of God, especially the mercy of God and the providence of God. And we see God equipping his people then and equipping us now for a life that is new and fresh and unique. These events in 2 chapters, I couldn't read it all. It would just be way too much for us to digest at one sitting. But chapters 9 and 10, the events, the characters, the customs, their way of life, all that they're doing seem to have absolutely zero resemblance to life in modern South Florida. And yet, if you read this passage backward, and what I mean is not just to go with the Hebrew, which actually does go from right to left if you read it that way, but if you read it from the New Testament backward, Richard Hayes from Duke Divinity School wrote an amazing book called Reading Backwards, and it looks at the 4 Gospels through the lens of the Hebrew Scriptures, really opens it up in a new way. And if you read this passage backward, you'll see emerging from it pictures of big realities that are in our modern lives as we seek to live a life of true spirituality. So let's look today, very simple, under 3 headings: the story, the symbol, and the serving. Story, symbol, serving. What I mean by serving is how this passage can be brought to serve us or help us as we seek to live the Christian life and learn to live in new and liberated ways. So again, story, symbol, and service. You may remember the way this book started. It said there was a man named Elkanah, but turned out the story was not about Elkanah, it was about his wife Hannah. And here, once again, it's like a new start to the book. There was a man named Kish, but the story is not going to be about Kish. It's going to be about his son, whose name is Saul. This is a wealthy family, a family of the aristocracy of that tribe of Benjamin. They came from a long line of strong and powerful Benjamites. Saul, the son of Kish, is a handsome, tall guy. Says he's literally head and shoulders above the crowd. He's sent along with the foreman. It says, take one servant with you. Probably that means the one servant, the foreman of Kish Industries. So take the CEO of the family business with you and go and find some lost livestock, some donkeys. And the donkeys got away, and Saul is sent with this foreman to find them. And they search all over the place. You can see the cities, which I kind of tripped on in verses 4 and 5, all those big names. Until they search for so long that Saul becomes concerned for his father. He says, my dad will now no longer be concerned now for the donkeys. Now he'll be concerned with me. So let's head back, let's call it quits. But the foreman convinces him, wait, we happen to be in a city where there is a renowned man of God, a seer. And this prophet will see where the donkeys are and he'll help us. And you begin to see very early in this episode that all these coincidences are really the invisible hand of God, the providence of God. By the way, providence, I think a lot of people don't know what that word means, and they say, well, everything that I've needed, God has given me. His providence is great. He's provided for me. It doesn't really mean that God has provided. It means that he governs and preserves all of his creatures and all of their actions. It's really a better synonym might be control. God has total control over everything that's going on. It's a big idea in this story. And as they arrive outside the town, and this is the part I skipped over, they see a bunch of young women coming out to draw water. And the women, and Hebrew scholars will tell you this, the women appear to be giddy. And the Hebrew changes style at this point. It gets choppy and gets really fast paced, as if, you know, the girls are swooning over tall Saul. And by the way, a lot of matchmaking in the Bible takes place at wells. I don't know if you've ever noticed that, but it doesn't happen for Saul this time. Even though the girls are giddy, Saul doesn't have time for that. He's just looking for those donkeys. And when they get to the gate where the women said, you can find this seer, he's on a mission. He went back to his house. He was just at the well. If you run right now, you can catch him. When they get to the gate, and the gate in the Bible is where business is transacted and when where judgments are rendered, when they get there, they see a man, and they ask this man for directions to the seer's house. Turns out, though, that the man is the seer. And now we learn that the seer is our old friend Samuel. And the seer has seen, because that's what seers do. They see. He has seen Yahweh, the God of Israel, has revealed to his prophet, the seer, Samuel, that a man from Benjamin will come looking for him, and that Samuel, the prophet, the seer, was to anoint this man with oil as the prince, as the king elect. And that he, this newly anointed king, will save Israel from their nemesis, the Philistines. By the way, if you've been really paying attention, you might remember it said the Philistines didn't come back into town as long as Samuel was there. Now we learn that it probably meant as long as Samuel was the leader. Now Samuel is not going to be the leader, and they're back. The Philistines are coming back. And God adds, I have seen my people suffering, and I have heard them cry out to me. Two big themes in this passage. Providence and mercy. The providence and mercy of God. And then Samuel, the seer, the prophet priest, says to tall Saul, thus saith the Lord, behold the man, the one I told you about, he will restrain or govern my people. So Saul didn't recognize the seer, but the seer recognized him. And when Saul asked directions, by the way, how humble is Saul? He's a man asking directions. And, you know, men don't ask directions, just a sign of how humble this man began. And Samuel, the seer, says, you're looking for the seer's house? Well, this is your happy day. I am the seer. Now let's go. We're late. Late, says tall Saul. Late for where? I'm just looking for my donkeys. Of course, God's providence has bigger things in mind than the donkeys. So Samuel the seer says, oh, those donkeys that were lost 3 days ago, you remember 3 days is that number in the Bible where death dies and life comes to life, and where bad news ceases and good news replaces it. Yeah, he says, they've been found. Don't think about the donkeys, because all Israel is thinking about you and your father's house. We've been waiting for you. Everyone wants to meet you. And tall Saul says, meet me? I think you must have the wrong guy here, because I'm from Benjamin. Benjamin is the tribe that almost went extinct just a generation ago. The tribe was almost wiped out, And we're like one of the smallest family lines in the tribe. I really think you have the wrong guy. And Samuel says nothing. He just ignores him. And they arrive at the high place, which was like a place where it could be an idolatrous worship outpost, or it could be like a synagogue, is what it appears to be here. And they arrive at this high place, this fellowship hall, and all the elders of this synagogue, this high place, are gathered, and Samuel the prophet takes his own seat, and he gives it to tall Saul at the head of the whole table, the seat of honor. And Saul is seated there. And I'm sure Saul is thinking to himself, why did he put me at the head of the table? And then Samuel the seer calls the chef out of the kitchen and says, hey, remember that piece, that cut of meat that I gave you earlier in the day? And I told you to reserve it for a special guest of honor. This is the guest of honor. Bring it out now and serve him. And the cut of meat that would normally go to the priest is now given to tall Saul. And I'm sure Saul thinks to himself again, there's obviously a big mistake here. I mean, this is the best leg of lamb I have ever had, but I am not the high priest. And Samuel the seer says, I know you're not the high priest, but what you don't understand and what I do is you are my successor. You're gonna take over for me. You're my son. And today I'm adopting you, and that's what this meal is about. This is a dinner in your honor to celebrate your coming reign. You're taking over for me, son. And I'll explain it all in due time. But for now, enjoy the meal. So, very last verse, what I just read. Saul ate with Samuel that day. And again, Saul is probably thinking, it's the best meal I've ever had, but this prophet has the wrong guy. I just want my donkeys. You know, the English poet John Milton, he wrote his most famous works called Paradise Lost. And he wrote a sequel to Paradise Lost called Paradise Regained. And in that sequel, he makes reference to this actual episode, and he describes Saul in these words, as he who seeking asses found a kingdom. In other words, he's looking for one thing, and he found something infinitely more valuable. God is governing and preserving all of his creatures and all of their actions, especially for the welfare of his own church. And that's where I want to begin my second point. You remember my 3 points? Story, symbol, and how this can serve us. And the second point is symbol. Saul is a kind of symbol, a symbol of the man or woman who's going about life. She's working her job. She's collecting her pay. She has no great aspirations about what this day may bring. No big hopes, no big dreams. It's just another day, and every day is basically the same. And then, in the words of that song, which you might know, happiness hit her like a train on a track coming towards her, stuck still. No turning back. She hid around corners. She hid under beds. She killed it with kisses, and from it she fled. But happiness still found her out. In other words, this big Saul, handsome, oblivious guy looking for donkeys. He seems like a good guy. He seems like a dutiful son. In fact, he's more than just obedient. He actually thinks about his father worrying about him. And Saul is looking high and low for one thing, but he finds something else. In fact, I think we have to say, not that he found it, but that it found him. Happiness hit him like a train on a track. It found, and to call it really is the wrong thing. He found Saul, the prophet, the word, God himself found Saul when Saul was running in a different direction looking for donkeys. See, this is a symbol of me. He might say, TJ, are you kidding me? Are you saying that God wrote this, that you're somehow in the Bible? Well, look, I was 19 years old. I went to work that day with no real expectation for anything except that I might find a paycheck at the end of the day. And happiness hit me like a train on the track. Suddenly, I found myself sitting at a banquet, surrounded by a synagogue, people like you, a great cloud of witnesses, friends that I never knew I had, all of a sudden came out of the woodwork to welcome me. The word of God was there to tell me that, yes, I did actually belong at this table for a king, and that somehow I was of royal blood, and that I was being adopted and embraced and accepted, that God had plans for me. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope. And when Saul was anointed with that fragrant oil the next day, in the next chapter, it says Saul kissed him and anointed him with oil. And then Samuel said to him, has not Yahweh anointed you ruler over his inheritance? And tall Saul had to be standing there as the oil is dripping down his head. He must have been thinking to himself, what in the world is going on here? And Samuel, the seer, gives Saul three confirmation tests. Look, three things are going to happen to you here. And they'll all confirm what I'm telling you, that I'm not just a crazy man, I'm actually a seer and a prophet from God. And each of those signs comes to pass exactly as Samuel said it would happen. You were looking for donkeys, but God was looking for you. And the three signs confirm it. But the third sign is that Samuel says, when you are on your way, you'll see a whole group of prophets coming from worshiping Yahweh. And when you see these prophets, they'll be prophesying. They'll be playing instruments. And they'll be singing and dancing. And Saul actually saw these guys, and as he approached the prophets and the prophets approached him, it says the Spirit of God rushed from the prophets onto Saul, and Saul began to prophesy. And it says, quote, he was changed into another man. And then it goes on a couple verses later and says, God changed his heart. And the people who saw it said, I thought this was the son of Kish, guy with all the donkeys. Turns out, he's actually the son of Samuel, because this whole situation is an adoption story. Samuel is the father of the prophets. And Saul is prophesying, that makes him a prophet, that makes him the son of Samuel. He was the son of Kish, but now he's the son of Samuel. Samuel is his spiritual father. Later, Samuel does this elaborate ceremony in which he gets all the elders of Israel together, men from all the tribes, and he says, come here, check out what's happening here. And he gets members of all the tribes lined up. And he says, you two, let's take Zebulun and Issachar. Roll the dice, all right? Zebulun's out, Issachar's in. And he goes all the way down like the March Madness. It's all the way to the bracket of Benjamin. And he says, all right, let's keep on rolling the dice. And he rolls the dice again, and then he gets down to the family of Kish. And then he rolls the dice again, and within the family of Kish, he lands on Saul. All the tribes are crossed out one by one until he gets all the way down to Saul himself. And he asks him to stand up. Saul,
The lot has fallen to you. You are going to be the new king of Israel. Stand up so everyone can cheer for you. Saul? Has anyone seen Saul? And he's gone. And then Samuel goes into a kind of trance. And God tells him, Samuel, Saul is hiding in the luggage room. Hi, Saul. Sorry to bother you. Could you just come out? You're being recognized as the king of Israel. And once again, everyone shouts out, long live the king, long live the king. And Saul must have been thinking, I don't know what's going on. This is like a dream. This is just too good to be true. And there are other symbols or analogs in this passage. Samuel the seer says of the man who is anointed, and that word anointed, I hope you know this, because even if you don't know any Hebrew, you can still see this over and over again in the Old Testament. The word anointed is the Hebrew word Mashiach, Messiah. So Saul is now anointed or Mashiach, and he is a Messiah figure at some points in the Old Testament. And it says in verse 17 of today's text, when Samuel saw Saul, when the seer saw the king elect, the Lord said to the seer, behold the man. Now, have you ever heard that phrase in the Bible before? Behold the man. I'm reminded of that time when the Lord Jesus Christ was on trial and Pilate wanted to let him go, but the crowd wouldn't let Pilate do what he wanted to do. And finally, he torments him, tortures him, puts a crown of thorns on his head and brings him out in front of all the crowd and says, Ecce homo, in the Latin Vulgate, famous words, behold the man. And I think also of John the Baptist in John's Gospel, chapter 1. Remember? Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. I think of God the Father at the baptism of Jesus. Behold my Son, in whom my soul takes delight. I think of Saul, the symbol, and how his life and his experience at this point point us to and mirror Jesus Christ, who would be the true King of Israel, and went looking at one point in his own life for a donkey. He said, TJ, I've read the Gospels many times and I don't remember Jesus ever going looking for donkeys. But do you remember when he was about to go into Jerusalem for the final time? He sent two disciples to go looking for a donkey. But instead of the donkey, which in this case was a young, unbroken donkey, which had never been ridden, instead of the donkey running away from Jesus so that Jesus had to go looking for him, he, the king of creation, sat on this donkey, which was waiting for him, as it were. And it says the donkey had never been ridden. And I've said to the congregation before, what happens when you sit on a donkey that has never been ridden? One minute you're on the jackass, and the next minute you're on your rear end. And Jesus Christ is not bucked off the donkey, because it's as if the donkey is saying to himself, finally, whew, a man who is not going to beat me and hurt me, but a man I can finally trust, that this must be the Lord, the King of creation. And the donkey, as it were, gives himself fully to be ridden. And this is the Lord of creation who goes now into Jerusalem to pay the price so that he might redeem all creation and make it new. The mercy of God, the providence of God, in today's text, God has just been rejected by his own people. Give us a king. We don't want God to rule over us. And yet God is still merciful toward Saul and his people. He hears their cry. I see my people because their cry has come to me. Even when they sin so decisively against him, God still loves them. He longs to show them mercy and forgiveness. Why? Because as Thomas Watson said, mercy is his darling attribute. Mercy is the thing when God looks in the mirror that God most admires about himself, his mercy. Now, I don't think many of you tomorrow are going to go looking for your donkeys. So again, this might seem so far out and different from the world in which we live, but how do you put it to work? How can this passage serve you tomorrow and enhance and help you in your spiritual life? Story, symbol, and service. That's my last point. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, do you see all that is yours in Christ? Now, you may be a covenant child raised in a family of believers. Was that coincidental that you were born in that family? Or you may be, like me, someone running hard away from God who was arrested at some dramatic point in your escape plan and God reeled you in. But do you see all that is yours? That you are chosen and then pursued by God, given gifts, confirmed by signs and seals, that is the sacraments, that you're given a new heart, you're made into a new person. You have an anointing from God, and despite what some weird people on television teach, every Christian has the anointing from God. 1 John 3:20, you have an anointing from the Holy One that you will know the truth. And just like Saul was at the banquet, surrounded by brothers who were cheering him on that he had never even met before, so you too are surrounded by witnesses right now in this sanctuary, witnesses here, and even witnesses on the other side who are cheering for you to run with endurance the race that is set before you. Do you see that a place has been reserved for you at an eternal party? Here's how it's described in the prophet Isaiah. The Lord of hosts will prepare a lavish banquet for all peoples on his mountain. A banquet of aged wine, choice pieces of meat, and refined aged wine. An eternal party. Do you see that if you are in Christ, that you are right now, as you go searching for your donkeys tomorrow, as you go about your routine tomorrow, do you see that you are right now as good as there? That a place is reserved for you? And even now with all this weird stuff that's going on, again, looking out on a congregation that's wearing masks to church, do you realize that with all the weird stuff that's going on in the world today, that in a very real sense, you're not really here, but you're already there in with Christ seated in heavenly places, forgiven, declared righteous, adopted, secure, significant, and loved beyond what you've ever imagined? See, if you're a Christian, you should think about this more. I mean, all that's yours in Christ. You really should. It'll change the way that you live on a daily basis. What I mean is, really, buy a hymnal. You know, we sang Jesus, I am resting today. You should sing that song every day. I am finding out the greatness of your loving heart. I mean, it takes a whole lifetime and it will take all eternity. Your most important obligation right now is to look at all that Jesus Christ is, all that he has done for you, and all that he, by his Spirit, continues to do to keep you and to liberate you and to change you into the image of the perfect human being. That God's providence and God's mercy are for you. That's your biggest obligation, to see that, because that is what will really change the way you approach your daily life. And I'm speaking to those in our sanctuary, most of whom I know, and I'm speaking to those who are watching this online. If you are not yet a Christian, happiness is seeking you. Why do you think you're listening to this sermon today? Do you think it's by accident? Because I'm telling you, it's not by accident. It's due to the mercy and providence of God. Wherever you are, think on these things with us. See that God has mercy and new life for you if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't run, don't hide, don't ridicule or downplay what we're saying. Look into Jesus Christ and what he has done for you in his life, death, and resurrection. You have questions? You say, TJ, I have too many questions. Bring your questions. Bring your doubts. Bring your objections. If it all seems too good to be true, I'm here to tell you, it is, and yet it is true. Today may be the first link in a long chain that God is forging to bind you to himself and to be bound to him is to be free indeed. Let's pray together. Father, we did not find a boring passage today that seems irrelevant, but once we peeled away a few layers, we found an exciting and unusual passage that claimed our attention and helped us see a picture of us, unworthy and yet embraced by God. And I pray, Father, that people who are listening to me today and think the mercy of God is too unreal and may just be fake news, we pray, Father, that you would open all of our eyes to see the gospel for what it really is. Draw people to yourself, Father. Endow them with this anointing and make them to be new people, liberated in Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let's stand now and sing.
Is to overcome the temptation.
tempter, ours to call in dangers are. In his strength we dare to battle all the raging force of sin, and by him alone we conquer foes without and foes within. Father, grant your Holy Spirit in our hearts may rule today. Grieve not, quench not, but unhindered work in us his sovereign way. Fill us with your holy fullness, God the Father, Spirit, Son. In us, through us, and forever shall your perfect will be done.
I forgot to mention at the start of the service something that you heard about in our mail out this week, and that was the arrival, soon arrival, of the Lacys. I think we have a picture of them. Maybe they'll show up, and you can pray for them. This church has a great tradition of warmly welcoming new staff, so let's pray we'll be able to do that, and we're grateful for God's provision of them. Let's bow together now and receive God's blessing. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.